We're here to celebrate the life of Bernice Marie Walker Elgin. Born on Valentine's Day, February 14th, 1933. I understand the significance of this particular day. And then departed this world on Christmas Day, December the 25th, 2017. Born to John and Hilda Crane of Watertown, New York, she graduated high school in Allentown, Pennsylvania in 1952. And it was here that she met the love of her life, Thomas Walker. After they were married, they had their three beloved daughters. Thomas and Peggy moved to Largo, Florida in 1994, where they enjoyed the warmer temperatures and an easier lifestyle until Tom passed away in the year 2000. Bernice found love again, and she enjoyed 12 years of marriage with Albert Elvin in Largo before he too passed away. In 2014, Bernice moved back to Pennsylvania to be close to her daughter and remained there until she went home to Jesus on December the 25th, 2017. She survived by her three daughters, five grandchildren, five great-grandchildren. And so let us celebrate today the life of Bernice Marie Walker Elgin. Please pray with me if you will. Gracious Lord, we thank you for the life of Bernice. We thank you for the example that she left, the legacy that she leaves behind, for the family that loves her so much. We thank you, Lord, for what she brought into this world, this lady who never met a stranger. And so it is, Lord, today we come to her recognizing that she's now gone home to you. For her, we rejoice. For her, Lord, there is no pain, there is no more suffering, there is no more aging. She has a new body, and Lord, it is perfect for her. We rejoice that our faith tells us that. So therefore, our prayers, Lord, are particularly with those who are close, her children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren. We pray for them, Heavenly Father, right now, as they come to terms with a new life, a new normal, if you will, of life without God. Give them a special comfort and peace this day, I pray. And so may it be, Lord, that today as we go through this service, that we celebrate her life, a life well lived. May she be an example to each one of us, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
There are always favorite scriptures, and then there are favorite scriptures. And I think today, the reading that we have posted, and in particular, John 3, 16 and 17, will be significant to the life of Bernice Elgin. Reading from the New International Version. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be to want. He makes me lie down in green pastures, and he leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And then John 3, 16 and 17, probably the most familiar, one of the most familiar verses in all of Scripture, in all of Christendom. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, and have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. And may God add to us this day his blessing in the reading of his word.
We have a couple of special readings this afternoon. I'm going to read some words from one of my mum's favorite poets, that's Helen Steiner-Wright. And after that, Audie's going to come over and read something. But this is some words from Helen Steiner-Wright under the title, When I Must Leave You. When I must leave you for a little while, please do not grieve and shed with wild tears and hug your sorrow to you through the years. But start out bravely with a gallant smile, and for my sake and for my name, live on and do all things the same. Feed not your loneliness on empty days, but fill each waking hour in useful ways. Reach out your hand in comfort and in cheer, and I in turn will comfort you and hold you near. And never, never be afraid to die, for I am waiting for you in the sky.
The most beautiful word on the lips of mankind is the word mother, and the most beautiful call is the call of my mother. It is a word full of hope and love, a sweet and kind word coming from the depths of the heart. The mother is everything. She is our consolation in sorrow, our hope in misery, and our strength in weakness. She is the source of love, mercy, sympathy, and forgiveness. And now a poem by Khalil Gibran. And a woman who held a babe against her bosom and said, Speak to us of children. And he said, Your children are not your children. They are the sons and daughters of life's longing for itself. They may come through you, but not from you. You may give them your love, but not your thoughts, for they have their own thoughts. You may house their bodies, but not their souls, for their souls dwell in the house of tomorrow, which you cannot visit, not even in your dreams. You may strive to be like them, but not seek to make them like you. For life goes not backward, nor tarries with yesterday. You are the bows from which your children as living arrows are sent forth. The archer seeks the mark upon the path of the infinite, and he bends you with his might that his arrows may go swift and far. Let your bending in the archer's hand be for gladness, for even as he loves the arrow that flies, he loves also the bow that is stable.
Thank you. You know, when you describe somebody as crafty, you sometimes have to explain what that means. It's quite clear to me that Bernice was a crafty person, very clever when it came to a number of things. For instance, the cards. I always love when I get a handmade card, and actually Bernice, or if I might be familiar enough, Bernie. Bernie would send out these cards understanding what it meant to people to have something that was created by her and not simply a store-bought card like the one my wife got this morning, by the way. She must be quite a cook, by the way, quite a chef. I was amazed to see that her ability when it came to cooking brought it into the Archdiocese of Allentown. That she was the personal chef of Monsignor Harkin. But I think the thing that caught my attention was her ability to create stained glass. I love stained glass. You can tell by the way I speak, I'm not from around these parts. I think back to my homeland of England and the many beautiful cathedrals. And the highlight of any great cathedral is the stained glass. And if the sun hits the stained glass in the right way, it is a spectacular sight, as the glass reflects all the beauty of the sun. And I think that's a wonderful metaphor for Bernie's life, that she reflected the beauty of Jesus. She reflected the beauty of her Savior. You see, it's a call that all of us who call ourselves Christians have. We are to be reflectors of the light of Jesus. Some of us may do it standing in a pulpit. Others will do it quietly, working in the background, using talents and gifts. using a heart that is often sensitive. It wasn't lost on me as I looked at her life, the love of animals that she had. Barely a time without an animal in the home, I believe. But also, the fact that she never met a stranger. You know, that's a rare gift these days. That kind of person that, as soon as you meet them, you feel comfortable with them. I fear the world is little less because of the loss of Bernie. Because we need more people in this world who just love people. She clearly loved her family. Tom, Albert, daughters, grandchildren, great-grandchildren. And there lies this wonderful legacy that she leaves behind. And that's my prayer, is that legacy for her goes on in those that she knew, in her family and in her friends. Because as far as Bernie's concerned, she's fine. She has inherited the promise that she was given all those years ago, the promise on which she based her life. And that is eternity with Jesus. In 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 7, we read rather famously, "For we brought nothing into the world, for neither can we carry anything out." What a crazy existence life, isn't it, when you think about it? And it seems more frenetic these days. We live our lives at this crazy pace so that we can make enough money to make a better life for ourselves. We want the best of things. We want to provide for our families. But then by providing for our families, we spend less time with them because we want to make a better life for them. It's kind of a messed up thing. And then you kind of ask, well, to what end? Because at the end of all of it, we all go the same way. You see, the one certainty about life is that one day it will end. One day we will cease breathing. And all for what? All that toil is for nothing? Because we can't take anything beyond this world. Job said in chapter 1 of the book of Job, "The Lord gave and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised." And surely these words from the book of Job better explain the concept of bringing nothing into the world and therefore leaving the world with nothing. The reality is we do leave the world with nothing, but we gain everything. We gain everything. Jesus said in John chapter 5 verse 24 that someone like Bernie has passed from death into life. Eternal life is a reality for all who believe. Those who don't believe, time like this is a time to really start thinking. Start wondering, is there a heaven? Is there a hell? Consider which way you think you will go, and if you're not sure, you should be concerned. You see, in the Salvation Army, we have this wonderful phrase, and you see it right there before me. For someone like Bernie, who has passed from this life to the next, we say they have been promoted to glory. What a phrase. Isn't that a great phrase? Promoted to glory. And I think it's a great way of looking at Bernie and where she is now, having passed from this life to the next. But the truth is, for every one of us, that day of reckoning will occur. And therefore, surely the most important thing that we need to know is what happens at the end of this life. I can't think of anything that is more important than that. But I also believe that Bernie was convinced, and therefore she's inherited eternity. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9 says this: "As it is written, for no one's ever seen or heard anything like this, never so much as imagined anything quite like it, what God has arranged for those who love him." You see, that's what this life is all about. It's all about what's beyond. A promise of a place so wonderful that our wildest imagination cannot imagine what it's truly, truly like. It is so amazing, and it provokes the question, who wouldn't want that? Who wouldn't want that beautiful eternity? But you'd be surprised. You'd be surprised how many people don't want it or can't seem to see it. They see this life is all there is. I've even met people who don't think they deserve eternity, and perhaps none of us do, but that's where Jesus comes into the whole thing. And what we see in that verse I read earlier is the one demand, the one prerequisite of our eternity in heaven is to love God No one's ever seen or heard anything like this. Never so much as imagined anything quite like it. What God has arranged for those who love him. To love him is to trust him. To love God is to obey him. To love God is to desire to be with him. I'm the father of three children. And my daughter is the oldest. And she's 18, graduating high school this year. But some years ago, when she was quite small, probably about 4 or 5 years old, we went to visit her aunt, uncle, and all the cousins. And our daughter, whose name is Hope, was playing outside. And in the front yard of my sister-in-law's house, there was a platform. It was sort of an area the kids would play in. It was about 7.5 feet high. And somehow my little daughter had managed to climb and get onto this platform. But now she was stuck. And her aunt had come out to try and coax her down. She wouldn't come down. Her cousins, who were older, were trying to encourage her to come down. No, no, get my dad. Get my dad. My dad was taking a nap, truth be told, inside the house, so he had to wake me up and get me out there. And I got to the platform, and I saw my daughter's plight. I said, Hope, the first thing you need to do is sit on the edge of the platform. And so she did. I said, now, honey, I need you to drop into my hands, because I couldn't quite reach where she was. And she tipped forward and dropped into my hands, and I was able to take her down safely. Through the loving relationship she had with me, she trusted me. And through that trust, even though she was scared, she still obeyed me. I think that's the relationship that God desires to have with each one of us. Once we realize he is completely trustworthy, then we have the confidence to obey him, even in the most absurd of situations. And once we truly experience a relationship with Jesus Christ, all we want to do is to be with him. Sometimes I think we need to be more like the little children. But one thing I recognize this afternoon is it's all good talking about heaven, and we understand that and we believe that. But what I have before me are people who agree with it. People who are also feeling a sense of loss. And one thing I like to share whenever I do a memorial service or a funeral is a story from the New Testament that I think will give you some peace and comfort. See, there's a family that we learn about in the New Testament. A family that was very close to Jesus. They were two brothers and a sister, Lazarus, Mary, and Martha. And they were dear friends of Jesus. He loved them deeply. But Lazarus got sick. I mean, really sick. And so they got word to Jesus that Lazarus was sick. And the book of John tells this story, and John writes this. When the message got to Jesus, he said, "The sickness is not fatal. It will become an occasion to show God's glory by glorifying God's Son." Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, but oddly, interesting word in Scripture, but oddly, when he learned that Lazarus was sick, he stayed on where he was for 2 more days. But from the question, why didn't Jesus respond immediately? Well, Jesus has a full understanding of death. He gets death. He had a full understanding of that situation. And he had a full understanding of an incredible miracle that was going to occur. So the first thing to remember is Jesus is in control. He loves you just as he loved Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. So therefore, the story that unfolds, I pray, will bring comfort. John goes on to say, when Jesus finally got there, he found Lazarus already 4 days dead. Bethany was near Jerusalem, only a couple of miles away, and many of the Jews were visiting Martha and Mary, sympathizing with them over their brother. Martha heard Jesus was coming and went out to meet him. Mary remained in the house. Martha said, "Master, if you'd been here, my brother wouldn't have died. Even now I know that whatever you ask God, he will give to you." Remarkable thing, isn't it? To go out there and say, "Master, if you'd been here, my brother wouldn't have died." I mean, just absolute belief that Jesus would have stopped him from dying, would have saved her brother, if only, you will give. But then she takes it a step further with a remarkable statement. Even now, I know that whatever you ask God, he will give to you. It's a great statement of faith that even now, could you save my brother? Jesus said to her, your brother shall rise again. Martha said to him, I know he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? And here is a clear promise for Martha and for all of us who follow. Whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. My question to you this morning is, do you believe this? Now, Martha had gone out to greet Jesus. She was the practical sister. She was probably making sure that the mourners were taken care of, making sure there was food and drink for everybody. But Mary remained in the house. She was the very sensitive sister. And in many ways, she and Jesus connected in a remarkable way. John continues. Then when Mary had come where Jesus was, seeing him, Mary fell down at his feet, saying to him, Lord, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died. Then he saw her weeping, and also the Jews who came with her weeping. Jesus groaned in his spirit and troubled himself, and he said, where have you laid him? They said to him, Lord, come and see. And it says, Jesus left. If you see God as one who lives in heaven far from the world and who seems a little ambiguous to our plight, then consider what I just read and take it to heart today. He saw her weeping. He groaned in his spirit. And Jesus left. That's the God we worship and serve. The one who sees our pain and feels for us, gets upset for us. And I want you to find comfort in that today. Our God sees your hurt and pain, and it grieves him. And what he wants to do is to comfort you. That's what he wants to give to you, is a comfort, a peace. Her tears are not for burning. She's having the time of her life. Our sadness is our own, in that we are missing a woman who is truly worth missing. And so I say to you, Jesus comes to you.
Well, we're going to conclude the service this morning by singing probably one of the most famous hymns of the Christian church. But look at the words. It'll be on the screen in front of you. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, and now I see. And that expression, what the captain has just told us, is a part of the amazing grace of God, the unmerited favor. We don't deserve it, but he certainly gives it. And as we sing this together, let's think about Bernice and the years that we had with her and the years we'll have with her through eternity. Why don't you stand for me, please, and we'll sing together on these verses of amazing grace.
Was lost, but now been found, was blind.
wonderful event happened on February 14th, but what a more wonderful event happened on December 25th, because Denise went home to glory. Amazing. It's great. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for your goodness to us this day. Thank you for all the words that have gone forth in tribute to a lovely lady who not only loved, but showed her love through practical work and words. We thank you for all the experiences she's had through the years, the influence she's had on so many people, whether that be family or not outside. And we pray just now that you would honor and bless the family that remains. May they understand and know totally the amazing grace of God that changes lives and changed Bernice and changed ours. So we pray just now, Lord, that you would honor and bless all that has taken place this day and everything that is said and done. We pray it in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory. Amen. And in the final words at the bottom of this program, after which the commissioner will play, and please stay marching in. Peace I leave with you, the words of Jesus. My peace I give you. Do not give you as the world gives. Do not let your fears, your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. May I be silent. Thank you.